So this young lady up on the screen that you just saw, her name is Kay Foster. Now she's from Illinois, she's not from here in Texas. And I was reading, you know, I saw this news video on my Facebook page and I'm like, oh my gosh, this is perfect. I want that coach, he knows exactly what he's doing, he can help me out. So what I did was, I quickly got on the internet, did some research, and I found a website. Okay, well, that's perfect. So I clicked on the website, and I found a phone number. So I called up the phone number, and I get the receptionist at the school in Illinois. And as, you know, I quickly explained my situation to the, the secretary, thank you. I quickly explained my situation to the secretary, and she handed the phone over to a man. Now, in the news video, it says that the coach is a female. But a little funny fact: her husband also worked with her. He is a coach also, and together the two of them teach this young lady how to do gymnastics. I'm like, okay. So I start talking to him. I quickly explain my situation again, and I asked her if she would be willing to come down here to Texas and help me coach my student, or help me coach me to coach my student, learn his tips and his tools that he's used. And after much negotiating with my coach, Coach Price, and with Mary, which is Evelyn's mother, and with this coach from Illinois, his name is Greg. So after much negotiation, we finally got him to come down. He came down on June 12th. And so June 13th was the day I was gonna start learning how to coach. You know, this Evelyn, and it was awesome. I was super excited, and you know, Evelyn was excited and everything. So we get there, and everything worked out great. He was here for 10 days, from June 13th to June 23rd. He was here for 10 days. That gave me 10 days to learn some tools how to train Evelyn. It was great. It was awesome. In fact, I took like 30 pages of notes. I was like writing everything down to the point, to the decimal point. It was crazy. I had like 30 pages of notes. I wish I had bought them, but I didn't. I wish I had. I was writing all these notes. We were having a great time, and it was awesome. And finally, it was time for him to leave. He left on June 24th, and I took him to the airport. We have an airport in the Beaumont area. I took him to the Beaumont airport, and just before he got on his plane, I asked him two questions. I asked him, why did you never give up on your student? And two, how did you figure out all these teaching methods for Kay Foster? And his answer was very, very simple. Read Mark chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. That was his answer. Very simple. And then he got on his plane. So if you have your Bibles, very quickly, let's turn to Mark chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. If you don't have your Bibles, it will be up on the screen. It says, when Jesus returned to Capernaum several days later, the news spread quickly that he was back home. Soon the house where he was staying was so packed with visitors that there was no more room even outside the door. While he was preaching God's word to them, four men arrived carrying a paralyzed man on a mat. They couldn't bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, so they dug a hole through the roof above his head. Then they lowered the man on his mat down in front of Jesus. Seeing their faith, Jesus said to the paralyzed man, my child, your sins are forgiven. But some of the teachers of the religious law who were sitting there thought to themselves, what is he saying? This is blasphemy. Only God can forgive sins. Jesus knew immediately what they were thinking, so he asked them, why do you question this in your hearts? It is easier to say to the paralyzed man, your sins are forgiven, or stand up, pick up your mat and walk. So I will prove to you that I am the Son of Man, has authority on earth to forgive sins. Then Jesus turned to the paralyzed man and said, stand up, pick up your mat and go home. Then the man jumped up, grabbed his mat, and walked out through the stunned onlookers. They were all amazed and praised God, exclaiming, we've never seen anything like this before. It was great. So, as I was reading this, I was like studying it. I'm like, okay, well, what am I trying to learn here? You know, Coach Greg told me to go to this verse, but what am I trying to learn? What is it he's trying to teach me? What is it that God's trying to teach me? And after reading it several times, I was able to pick up seven different things. I learned seven different things from this one passage. So, the first thing I learned was the paralyzed man represents Evelyn. Okay? Everyone has a prosthetic leg, and the paralyzed man, he was paralyzed, and he couldn't walk. Right? That's pretty easy. Number two, the crown represents the difficult responsibility given to me, having a tough time finding a solution. So I was going all around, I'm like, oh my gosh, what am I going to do? I have this student, but I don't know what I'm going to do with Evelyn. I mean, I don't know how to teach a student with a prosthetic. I don't know what to do. So how does this apply to your lives? You know, how can we use this in our lives? You're all going to face tough challenges and responsibilities, and finding a solution might seem impossible. It's going to seem really hard, like, oh my gosh, what am I going to do? You know, what do I do? Number three, the hole in the ceiling the friends made represents God providing a solution to my situation. Okay? So God sent me a coach from Illinois when I needed help the most. I mean, I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't know what I'm going to do. Now, many times you all are going to face challenges in your life, okay? And it's going to seem impossible to overcome. It's like, oh my gosh, I can't get through this. I don't know what I'm going to do. But guess what? God will make a hole. God will make a way for you guys and help you out. Isn't that great? That's awesome. Number four. The friends represent determination. So you know how in the passage there were four friends carrying this paralyzed man on a mat? There were four friends. Instead of just giving up their paralyzed friend and saying, oh, I'm sorry, we want to go see Jesus. No, they didn't do that. They decided to help their friend and try and bring him to Jesus as best they possibly could. So instead of just giving up when the crowd was there, what did they do? They climbed the side of the building and created a hole in the ceiling. Can you imagine having to climb up this vertical wall here to get to the roof and somehow dig a hole? I mean, I'm sure they had a ladder, but still, that would be hard to do, carrying a man up a 90-degree vertical wall and down into the house. That would be pretty hard. Now, for you guys, when we're facing difficult situations, don't give up. Don't quit. You know, just keep fighting. Keep going through it. Because guess what? God's going to make that hole for you. Isn't that cool? Number five. The four friends also represent friendship. You know, we're going to have times in our life where we don't know what to do, but we can rely on our friends. Isn't that cool? We can rely on our friends to help us. That's pretty cool. I mean, that's why our friends are here. It's like, hey man, I need some help cleaning my room. You mind helping me? Yeah, thanks. Cool. Thank you. Now, for me in my situation, I made a new friend from Illinois. His name is Greg. I mean, you can make friends anywhere. It's pretty cool. And God sent me this new person in my life, and now he and I are good friends. We chat all the time. You know, he trades, you know, new facts or new things that he's learned, and I can trade things that I've learned with my kids. It's pretty cool. Number six, the four friends that carried the man on the mat also represent God. Maybe they're going to be sometimes, hey man, can you help me clean my room? Your friend might say no, you know, because he or she might be busy. It's going to happen sometimes. What do you do? Well, there's also God. God also calls us our friend. No matter what's going on, no matter where our friends are, God is always there. And he's our best friend. In fact, actually on the back of your shirt, it says God is your friend. And Jesus is our friend. Isn't that cool? So no matter what's going on, no matter where our friends are, they might be busy, we still got a friend for us. That's pretty cool. And number seven, this is my last point. Number seven. Jesus healing the man at the end of the story represents a new future. The man got up and walked away, and I can only assume that the man who walked away probably achieved a lot of great things. What do you think? You think, you know, after standing up, he probably went to work, probably got himself a job, he probably even had a family, a very successful life. So because Greg was willing to teach me his tools and effectively help me, I can now teach my student, and now she can be an inspiration to the whole world. Just like Kate Foster, she says she's not an inspiration. She doesn't, you know, but that's her humbling herself, and that's great. For me, she's a huge inspiration to me, okay? And my student that I have, Evelyn, she's going to be a huge inspiration for other people who have a prosthetic leg, or for other people who have maybe a prosthetic arm or other things. She's a huge inspiration, and she's only 6 years old. That's crazy. She's only six. She's young. She's just a little kid. It's pretty crazy. So, for you guys, maybe, you know, after, you know, you're struggling with something, whatever it is, whatever's going on in your life, and when God helps you, guess what? Now you have the tools to be able to figure something out in the future if it comes up again. Hey, I don't know, I need some help cleaning my room. God, can you help me clean my room? Make sure this goes fast? Okay, yeah, good, all right. You clean your room really fast, and now you know where everything goes in your room. Pretty cool. So no matter what's going on, guess what? Now you have the tools. You've learned, God has now taught you something, and you can use that tool later on in the future. That's pretty cool. And maybe it might be another situation that you might not have faced, but you can use those same tools again. That's pretty cool. So I want to close with this really fast. Many times we all struggle with a lot of things, okay? We all do. Every day, including me, I struggle with a lot of things, okay? I go to school, and I have to study a lot, and I have to get a lot of homework. I'm like, oh my gosh, how am I going to get all this homework done and go to work and do a kids ministry and do kung fu? How am I going to do all this? It's a lot, okay? We all have a lot of problems. You know, we all have a lot of difficult things, a lot of problems, and we feel like, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? It just feels so hard. But guess what? If we trust God, completely trust God, He'll always help us, no matter what's going on. It's awesome. We can always rely on God. We can always trust Him, no matter what's going on. We can put our trust, our faith on God. I know that's difficult to understand because we can't see God. You know, God isn't just something that just appears and, oh my gosh, you know, He's going to help you clean. No, we can actually trust Him and put our faith in Him. He'll help us because He's our best friend, He's our brother, and He's our Father. It's awesome. It truly is amazing. Thank you, guys.